Rise of the Duelist and the 2020 MegaTins are coming out this month. Let alone the thing about that we're getting a ban list next month, early next month, hopefully. We have a lot to talk about in this video. Guys, if you're new to the channel, please make sure to hit the subscribe button, like button, and comment down below. Common question of the day. What are you going in on? Are you going in on Rise of the Duelist? Are you going in on 2020 MegaTins? And how much? Before I begin the rest of this video, I just want to say I want to make three announcements. Number one, my stash is starting to annoy me. I'm debating on shaving it. Comment down below if I should. I really don't know if I should. It feels weird. It's like my face is reminding me that it has a mustache on it. I don't know, it just feels awkward. I'd love to know what you guys think. Comment down below. I'm like just about to shave it, but I want to see what you guys think about that. Number two, Remote Duels just ended for the Gen Con, and it was really fun. I'll be honest, I'm wrong. I thought Remote Duels was going to be terrible. It was a phenomenal experience. And if you're out there and you're going, V, how do we get involved in Remote Duels? Well, I'm going to show you the equipment you need to buy in order to play it. And to be honest with you, it's not that expensive. Though I will show you alternative equipment, which can be more expensive in this video as well. Also, guys, definitely look into Remote Duels because it's fun. I mean, I paid $12. I won a win-a-mat. The mat's $140, let alone the fact that I'm getting three packs, and you're still paying $12. When we used to do Remote Duels, you know, in regular Yu-Gi-Oh! Events, it was still about $12. So I don't know how these companies are paying for the shipping, how this is working out, but we are really being taken care of when it comes down to it. And I'd love to know in the comments down below if you guys are interested in, maybe we should do a Remote Duel tournament in my Discord. I'm debating on it. If you're not part of Discord, click the description, a bunch of great links down there, and check it out. All right. Real quickly, my throat isn't 100%. It's getting better, so that's what I'm doing. I'm not going to be able to yell as much in this video, but it's we're getting there. So hopefully as the throat clears, I could give my paisano chant. I just can't do it right now. Listen, looking at Rise of the Duelist, I think the biggest card in this set, obviously, is Triple Tactical Talents. I mean, this card's insane. Your opponent activates a monster effect during your main phase. You could draw two cards, take control of one monster. So, okay, it's Pot of Greed. It's Change of Hearts, or it's Confiscation for my older Yu-Gi-Oh! Players. If your opponent activates a monster effect during the main phase, are you going to main this card, or are you going to side this card? Is this a card you really want badly, or you kind of want it? I really don't know my take on this card. I kind of want this card. Looking at it being $80 to $90, I'm not sure if it's worth it. Being the fact that, you know, if you want to play competitive Yu-Gi-Oh!, like real competitive Yu-Gi-Oh!, you're going to need Lightning Storms. That's already a ton of money. So I'm like debating on this card. I really don't know if I should go in and grab it or not. And I'd love to know what you guys think in the comment section down below. Looking at everything else in Rise of the Duelist, I mean, first of all, I think this set is a really good set, just overall. I just want to say it out there right now. I think this is a very clean set. I mean, besides Triple Tactical Talents, and of course, you know, Dogmatica Starlight Rares, which is going to be insanely expensive, Dogmatica comes in this set. And it's kind of something that a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh! Players have been looking forward for a while. But it's the major drill, the major deck core, or sub-deck core, depending how you want to look at it, in this set that Yu-Gi-Oh! Players want, as well as Triple Tactical Talents. For Brand Drop, it looks very interesting. I'm not sure if it's going to be used or not. And there's a lot of great cards in here. I mean, tons of great cards in here. Shadow Schism. If you're a Shadow player, read this card. It lets you banish monsters in your graveyard to future summon Shadow monsters on your opponent's turn. And we're not done yet. And if your opponent has a... let's say you bring out, like, Window, which is a dark monster. If your opponent has a dark monster, banish it upon resolution of effect of activating Shadow Schism. That is broken, and that's an ultra regular set, which is about $350. I think, once again, there's a lot of great cards in here. I think a lot of YuGiOh players are going to be having a great time with this set. I'm really excited to see what YuGiOh players do with this set. I mean, especially if you're looking to play Dogmatica. There's an Invoke variant going around, and if you want Secret Invoke Mecha Book coming out of Fusion of Forces with a $15 market price, it's not that. A limited drop flavor around $31. First edition versions are almost near $40 for Invoked Mechabot. And don't forget the fact that you need Invocation. But don't worry about it. It came out of Bowser Legends. It's only about $23 in Secret Red Bowser Legends. You can still get the Super Rares for $19. The original Prince Secret Rares out of Fusion of Forces are roughly around $30. And if you want Ultimate Rare Invocation, no big deal. It's only, what, $92 market price. But, you know, the real price point's roughly around $150. For one. So yeah, you know, Invocation, Yu-Gi-Oh cards. Up next, guys, we got the Hidden City. Now, a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh! Players are gearing up already and playing, and this is kind of a bit of a gamble, the Numeron deck core in decks that are already existing, like, you know, Subterras. Here's a question, though. If you're playing Numerons, are you okay with knowing the fact that there's a good chance you're going to be on the ban list? Now, obviously, I don't think Konami's going to be hitting Numerons. I don't even think Konami's going to be hitting Subterras, because there's so many variants of Numerons. Like Generator Numerons, Zodiac Numerons, you know, pure Numerons. There's so many variants. But I do think hitting S0 is something that's going to happen. We don't know what's going to happen to the link, the Mega Cyclops link, I believe it's called. We don't know what's going to happen to that link. I don't think it will happen to the link. So there's still a chance for Numerons to be viable, because that card's insane. But I do think S0 will definitely get hit, as it's such a hardcore stun card. Looking at the Hidden City right now, the main card that's being used in Subterras, the Super Rare Adificity Gadgets with a $10 market price is already up to roughly around $13, almost near $13. If you want the original print Secret Hidden City coming out of Dark Illusions with a $13 market price, yeah, I mean, it's roughly around $16, or actually realistically $18 for that card. So Hidden City is rising up in value, and I still think Altergeist is the better control deck, but with Numerons, it does put Subterras right now as it stands a little over the edge as a better control deck. I don't know if that's going to last a month, and if we're going to be honest with ourselves, I don't think it's going to. Up next, guys, Infernoble Knight Renard. With the new set coming out, Rise of the Duelist, Yu-Gi-Oh! Players that own Infernoble Knights are just basically keeping them, and Yu-Gi-Oh! Players that kind of want to get involved with the new set with Infernoble Knights are looking to buy into these cards. I mean, look at Renard right now. The card's back up to $29. You look at TCG Player, you got a small listing over here for about $30, and then boom, it's back up to $30 again. The card is just maintaining good value right now because of the hype. It better see play. If it doesn't see play, the value of Renard and Infernoble Knight, the rest of Infernoble Knight cards, will decline in value. My honest opinion, I think it's going to. I don't have hope for this deck. Maybe because it says Noble Knights in it, and if it's not, like, you know, I sold. I just don't care about it. Maybe it's that, but I just don't have the hope for it. I want to be proven wrong. I just don't think I will. Up next, guys, we have Numeron Network. Once again, a card coming out of Battle Legends Armageddon with a $13 market price. You're seeing it all over here for about $13. And to be honest with you, I'm really excited about, like, this card. I think it's fun. I think it adds a new dynamic to the game. It makes field spells good again. Field spells want to be played again. The problem is, S0 is probably going to get a hit. I think there's nobody that's going to disagree with you as far as S0 being a card that is going to get hit. I think we're all in agreement on that. So, yeah, if S0 gets hit, you have the Link 4, which I can't find over here. I'm not going to look for it, but you have a Link 4, which is not bad. The Numerons by themselves are actually really good. The only question is whether or not are you going to be playing this in your deck home moving forward. Because we're getting a lot of cards coming out, a lot of deck cores coming out, and sub deck cores. And then looking at Utopic Zexal, last week, Super Rare Zexals for the limited edition version of Maximum Crisis was about $7. Looking at the market price, it's showing to be $4.50. It's actually down to about $4. There's a wall of 62 here, so it's down pretty greatly. And then if you want the Shonja version of Utopic Zexal, $13 market price. The card, once again, is down again to roughly around $13. It was way higher than that. But the card, the value of this card is declining because everyone knows, hey, why are you going to go in and grab this card when we're probably going to get it's a long time coming when it comes on the Utopic Zexal. This is something that Yu-Gi-Oh! Players that have been playing for a while know. We're due this to happen. Up next, guys, we got Necros, another thing that can be ran with Dogmatica. And the thing is, here's the question. Are you going to get your Necros core? Now, are you going to get your Secret Red Necros core, which includes Necros of Brionic, Secret Red of the Secret Forces, $52 market price, unlimited copies of the card, about 43. My first versions are going to run you about 50 for the Necros of Brionic for the Secret Rare. Or you're going to get your Ultra Rare Necros of Brionic, and this is where it gets kind of crazy. Ultra Rare from Duel Bauer with a $6 market price is actually down to about $4. Man, it's there's such a huge differential in the prices of these cards. It makes it really hard to know what to get, because I personally like Max Rarity, but I don't like throwing good money away and make it into bad money. And I feel like if you didn't already own a full Max Rarity Necros core, there's no sense in going and buying it right now. You know what I'm saying? Especially when we're going to be having a ban list. Especially when Necros might not be the best deck. Necros Dogmatica, it might not be the best deck. Who knows? But one thing I think we should know for sure, if you are still debating on it, buying Sakura makes no sense. Even if you like the high rarity, I would recommend you go ahead and buy the ultra rares, being the fact that they're so insanely cheap. Valkyries is $1 from Dual Power, but when we look over here from the Secret Forces Valkyries, it's actually roughly around $16 to $18. That's a big price difference. Like, it makes no sense. You know what, Necro players? If you want to have your Secret Rare, Max Rare, and Necros, that's on you. You deserve it. You held it for a long time. That's for you. And every other Yu-Gi-Oh! Player, buy a cheap deck core. Like, let's be real with ourselves. It just makes no sense to put this kind of money into something that may or may not pan out. So, let's talk about the 2020 Megatins. I want to flip the script in this video. The 2020 MegaTins is coming out at the end of this month, and a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh! Players are getting involved. Whether you're buying a couple of MegaTins, whether you're buying a bunch of cases, or whether you're buying a bunch of singles by using my TCG Player link down below, that'd be great if you did that. Whatever you're doing, we gotta talk about what's in the MegaTins, because everyone's excited about Red Eyes Dark Dragoon. Everyone's excited about the MegaTin itself, because it looks gorgeous. It definitely does. I might buy some just because I like the tin for my collection, as well as getting Red Eyes Dragoon, which is a pretty good card, I've been told. But we don't know about what's actually in the MegaTins. Imagine all this hype based off the promo and the aesthetics. That's how good of a job I really do think Konami did on the way to MegaTin looks like, as well as finally bringing us Dragoon, okay? The issue is, and my biggest issue is, anyone buying multiple cases, once again, going back to it, that's not a car store owner, that's not a vendor that can have the ability to pre-sell Yu-Gi-Oh! Singles on TCG Player, is more than likely going to lose money. And I'm going to show you right now, okay? We're going to go over the sets. Savage Strike, Dark Neo Storm, Rising Rampage, Chaos Impact. Okay, those are the sets. So first set they said was Savage Strike. Now, excuse me. Looking at Savage Strike, I think Pot of Extravagance being in the Megatins, it's not too shocking to me. It's not shocking to me if Pot of Extravagance was in the Megatins, even though we just got added to Chaos, because when we look at Dragonic Diagram, it kind of followed the same suit. It was in the Megatins of 2018, and it was in Battle Legends. Literally within a couple months apart, it was in both sets, added Secret Rarity. Looking at the Megatins, to see Pot of Extravagance being in there, wouldn't it be a big shocker? In fact, here's the question, are you going to sell yours or keep yours? Anyway, looking at the rest of the cards in here, Bolo Savage Dragon, the card everybody wants as a one-of. This is important. This is really emphasizing this point. This is a one-of, okay? So the minute someone opens a five cases of Megatins or a case of Megatins, and everything past one in Bolo Savage Dragon that they pull, they're more than likely going to sell because they'll still be a little bit high. And as they put those on the market, the value will obviously go down. And it's going to happen for a lot of cards. Fantastical Dragon Phantasmate, which kind of does not really seem as much play, but it's still a good card, and has a recent reprint that's relatively negotiable on its current price point, but that'd be kind of cool to see the Megatins. War Legacy Guard Dragon, a card that's only being used in Rockets right now. That's all it's being used in. And to be honest with you, it's decent, but is it really worth a $14 price point? Is it even worth, what's going to happen when the Megatins come out? Is it going to maintain that price point even remotely near it? Probably not. I think the War Legacy Guard Dragon at a Savage Strike could probably have like a $4 market price. Oh, real quickly, Konami said with the Megatins as well, is they're going to have Prismatic Secret Rares. So there's a possible chance for the Pot of Extravagance you're looking at right now, Secret Rare, that's $56 in the market price, to have a Prismatic Secret coming out. That Secret Rare will be just way lower than a Prismatic Secret. There's no doubt in my mind. It could be possible that Bartle Savage Dragon gets a Prismatic Secret, which make Yu-Gi-Oh! Players want to buy that version over the Ultra Rare, and the Ultra Rare currently right now is $65. So there's always the possibility of these cards coming out in that variation and form. Looking at Trickster Korriban, nobody wants this card. I kind of want it for my deck core. Maybe some Yu-Gi-Oh! Players out there want it as well, but nobody's going, man, do I have a spicy Trickster's list? This is not happening. So the value of this $9 Korriban getting reprinted in the Megatins would really do nothing. Witcher Strike is currently $7, sees almost no play. I do think that this card's a throwaway Secret Rare. I mean, even though I like the card a lot, and, you know, I don't know if it's going to be the good card. Here's the thing. In the Megatins, when you're looking at the spoilers of what's in the Megatins, look for what's not in the Megatins as far as Ultras and Secret Rares, because that's where the big value is. But going back to Witcher Strike, it's not bad. Not everybody wants, so that value will tank. Cypress Quan Dragon's going to tank. Psychic Wheel tank. Valkyrie Chef's tank. Super Anti-Kaiju War Machine Mecha Thunder King tank. These are all the Secret Rares. As far as Ultra Rares, they're already low, ready on the original set. So making them in the Megatin makes them throw away Secret Rares. People are going to get them and go, oh great, Danger Ogre Pogo. This card's $4, nobody wants it. Sure, here it is, I have it now. It means nothing. Moving forward, guys, we have Dark Neo Storm. Mech Deck Crusader Iron Max is another great card. It's seen no meta play, but you players will more than likely want to have a copy of the card. So that means every second copy, what happens? It's gone. It means nothing. It goes online. Value tanks. Cherubini, Even Angel, and the Burning Abyss is really cool. I don't know. Okay, so all the Burning Abyss players, I'm going to tell you right now, have this card already. They just have it. Just make peace with that. Here's the thing. If you are watching this video right now, would you really want this card? I kind of do. I kind of want it for casual Yu-Gi-Oh! And maybe other casual Yu-Gi-Oh! Players will want it. But I feel like a majority of Yu-Gi-Oh! Players are not going to want this card. The value will go down. No material. Once again, another card's currently $18. Yeah, that's gonna go. If it gets reprinted, it goes down. Pro Tour's a one of. That means nothing. Silent Mining's, we have Ultra Rare. It's dirt cheap already, so you players have that. I guess you can get the Secret Rare as well for the MegaTin release, but it's not gonna be expensive. Ghost of the Spooky Dogwood has an Ultra Rare, so nobody really wants it, but it's there. Mystic Mime is probably gonna get hit in the ban. It's $8. I mean, look at the rest of these cards. Kraton's $4, and that'd be actually a really good card to put in the MegaTins. But it's only for control players. You don't see, like, a mid-range player going, yeah, I need Crackdown. This is not happening. If the World Challenge is a card, now, here's the one thing I'm watching. I'm making sure if this gets reprinted or doesn't get reprinted. If it doesn't get reprinted, I kind of want to go in and grab a couple of these. Dean Gearsu got a reprint already. I mean, the Ultra Rare is worth $3. This card should be, like, $30. Nightmare Incarnation Islay is another card that, if it doesn't get reprinted, I'm going to go in and RO9 this. Because I think this is one of those cards that you have to go and rule 9 as soon as you hear about the Megatins. Because I think a lot of you players are going to be watching out for that. Especially after watching this video. So once again, looking at these cards, there's not much to want in Darkness Neostorm as a reprint. Let's move on. We have Chaos Impact, another set. We're probably not going to get Starlight Rares. Call it a hunch. Looking at IP Mask Arena, everybody more than likely has it. The card's still roughly around $39. And in the Megatins, it would definitely be a card that you players will still want. So it's a good card. But do they want 2 and 3 of this card? No, wrong. They want 1 of this card. Starlight Seafood only really works in Rockets as well as Striker Dragon. This is decent for the players that want to play Rockets, but for everybody else, they don't want this card. And then we go into, like, hardcore. You open your Mega Pack, and you get Throwaway Secret Rares. Let's talk about it. Even though I like Unchained, it's going to be the Throwaway Secret Rares. So Abominations Prisoners, Unchained Abominations, Unchained Soul of Rage, Salamon Great Pyro Phoenix, Unchained Soul of Disaster, Firewall Dark Dragon Dark Fluid, Unchained Soul of Anguish. These are throwaway cards, let alone the other Ultra Rare cards I haven't mentioned that you're looking at right now. They are all throwaway cards. Cards that you wanted when it first came out in Kiss Impact that you not necessarily want anymore. Malicious Blue Tang, the card's a great card, definitely undervalued. But if it gets a Megaton reprint, do you really want it? Does everybody that opens this are looking to play Marine Cess? This is what I'm saying. There's a lot of throwaways. Let's move on. Next, guys, we have Rising Rampage. And hey, you know what? It'd be cool if Konami said, listen, we're going to make a prismatic version of Appaloosa. That would definitely add more of a chaser effect to the Megatins. You want to open Megatins because you would love to pull that prismatic Appaloosa, which, hey, it would be a lot easier to get than finding Rising Rampage packs right now. And getting a Secret Rare. Current Secret Rare version of that Blue is roughly around $78. So this will actually be good for the set. And then we just go down from here. Nobody wants Gizmic Orochi. Nobody's really playing that. It's currently $15 in the market price. Marine Cess Call Anemones. Same thing with other Marine Cess cards. Or maybe if you want to like do a tech choice in Mermels, I guess. This is one's got a card nobody's going to want. The value's going to tank. I'm looking at this in the context of everyone's opening Megatins. Everyone's looking at this. And what does everybody want as a whole? As opposed to what everybody wants individually. Maybe you got Mermel players out there that go, hey, listen, I want a Coral Anemone. The card's $13. I'll wait to the Megatin. And I'll just get it when it gets reprinted. Like, that's a really, really rational way of thinking. And I agree with that. But looking at a lot of these plays that are going to open a lot of this product, nobody wants Get Out. Fortunately, Trigreen Knight Romulus, Marissa Seahorse, any of the Dream Mirror cards, even though they're great. Marissa's Marble Rock, which is already 90 cents as a Secret Rare as original set, only printing. Can we just agree that there's not a lot in here? The last set we're going to talk about is going to be something that I wish Konami did do. Because not only did they say... Excuse me. Not only did they say all these sets, but they said and more. And besides the promos, which I think we kind of know and agree on, it's going to be the promos, I really wish Konami did things like this. You grab sub-deck cores, and you got the most wanted cards. So it'd be cool to like open your Megatin and pull Infinitrack Anchor Drill, Searcher, Watcher to Evil Eye, Infinitrack Fortress Mega Collapse. This actually is the relevant card that they run in Numerons. It'd be cool to pull these cards, which got the Madam Vary, which already had a reprint, but still, Infinitrack Harvester, like sub-deck chorus in Megatins, I think is going to save these trashy Megatins. Because if we're looking at the Megatins as a whole, just for the whole community, there's not much as far as short-term value. There's not much as far as the short-term want. And when you look at the MegaTins, can we just talk about real quickly? With the MegaTins, we're talking to two player bases currently right now. You're talking to the collector's player base, which obviously wants the 10, which obviously wants the Red Light Doctor Goon. Anything TV show-wise, they want instantly. So they're probably going to get this for that. Not a lot, but they will. You're going to throw the competitive Yu-Gi-Oh players because you have all the competitive sets. Savage Strike, Dark Neostorm, Rising Rampage, Chaos Impact. Like, you have all this competitive. But what do you have for casual Yu-Gi-Oh players? You have nothing. Like, seriously, nothing. Yes, you got a lot of sub-deck cores, and that's going to be great for those casual Yu-Gi-Oh players, I guess. But casual Yu-Gi-Oh players still want Searcher, Watcher, the Evil Eye. The card currently, right now, on the marketplace is $16. Lightning Preposition is roughly around $15 to $16 for this card. Like, people want this card still. Casuals want this card. It'd be great if this was in the MegaTins. Now you really speak to that player base. You go, hey, competitive players, we got all these sets that you want. Boom, there you go. Casuals, we got these subsets as well as the sub-cards of the core sets that we know you want. Boom. And then we go to collect them and go, hey, this is a TV show stuff. You win, and of course, the answer is going to be yes. You touch all three play bases, and you hit them hard. I think the collector's base is not as hard, but the MegaTins are more or less known as a reprint, so you really go in and grab two. So I think that's really important. All right, so let's talk about what you need for remote duels. If you're watching this video right now, and you want to learn how to play remote duels, by the way, if you don't want to play remote duels, you're insane. It's super fun. Like, it's absolutely hysterically fun. It's like playing physical Yu-Gi-Oh! Except I could use my own bathroom. It's like playing physical Yu-Gi-Oh! Except when I do this, I don't smell B.O. I just smell my suctions. It's like playing physical Yu-Gi-Oh! But I can get up and get a drink and not pay $18 for it. And then have my backpack shucked on the way back to my seat. It's amazing. And it's really fun. I think it's something a lot of you players just don't... They weren't sold on it properly, I feel like. And I feel like since they weren't sold on properly, they're not enthusiastic about it yet. But I think this is something that ultimately everyone's going to be on board on. So let's get involved and see what you need. Number one, you're going to need a boom arm. This is what a boom arm is. It's basically an arm that has a little clamp. There's a clamp. Can you see it? Okay. There's a clamp. Clamps to your table. And then it has this over here, and over here is where to connect your webcam to. Make sure you get a webcam that has one of these little connectors on it, okay? Now, as far as cameras, I mean, my favorite camera to use, ultimately, would be a Logitech C920. They're roughly around $70 on Best Buy if you can get them. This is probably the best overall camera, and the reason why I like this camera a lot, besides the fact that it does 1080p, it has a phenomenal microphone. I feel like playing this weekend, a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh players either had good microphones, or they had, like, their headphones plugged in, which kind of stunk. They had to use, like, the regular phone microphone, which is really crappy. The cool thing about a C920, specifically, is that the microphone is so phenomenal, and Logitech microphones in general, they're so phenomenal and clean that you don't necessarily need to go out and try to get another microphone. You can just connect it as is, connect the audio to the microphone, and it's good. It's really good, actually. If you want to up the price point, you can use a Rode PSA 1 to a mount studio boom arm. This is more or less what you're going to see. Let me show you guys real quickly. These are the boom arm right here. This is more or less what you're going to see. It's $100 a boom arm. It's what you see what I personally use for my microphone stand as I wait for my new microphone to come in, but this is what I use on my microphone stand, and this is definitely overkill, but it's the best microphone boom arm in the market, period, hands down, no questions asked. If you want the best, there it is, it's $100. Now, if you want to upgrade your camera, you can get something like a Logitech Brio. This is an ultra 4K webcam. You're probably not going to use 4K if you're doing remote duels, but it's always good to have access to that. So you get a webcam like this, and it has a little, once again, that little connector on the back. Here's the whole boom arm, and you just take that bad boy without dropping it probably, and boom, look at that, connects right there, and then you got a way to play Yu-Gi-Oh! Connected here, let me see, it's facing down, connects there, and there you go. Now for some of you, you're gonna go, V, I live in a small, cramped, crappy-ass basement apartment. I've been there, Paisanos. I've lived in way worse conditions. This is what you need to do. If you don't have a good enough table, I got you, still, bro. You get one of these dinner tables. You got a playmat, probably. I hope. If not, don't worry about it. You can do it on a dinner table. You get one of these clean dinner tables. Now, this one's a little more expensive. You go to, like, Walmart, Best Buy. You can probably grab a cheap one. You don't need the Ritz. You just need a cheap one. And this will connect your boom arm. How do I know? Because I connected my boom arm to it when I used to do deck profiles a long time ago. This thing works really good. And there's your table. You don't got a chair? No problem. Stand. It's a good way to work out and play remote duels. Nevertheless, I think remote duels is something that's really fun. I think it's something that hopefully Konami will definitely push more of. I mean, being able to play at Yu-Gi-Oh! Level Advanced by being home is a big deal for me. I like it a lot. And even though I'd rather go and travel and go to events, it is cool knowing that I don't have to go and travel 6, 7, 8 hours or fly. That's like $300, let's say. Get a hotel for the weekend, another $300. Food, which is obviously, since you're at a convention center, it's going to be insanely expensive. And not the best, by the way. And then go to an event, which is really packed and with smelly players. Even though I kind of like that, which is so weird, but I do love doing that. It's fun as an experience. Having the ability to stay home, connect my boom arm to my table and just play Yu-Gi-Oh! As well as walk over to my fridge and get my own chips, soda, have my dinner and everything like that. Go use the bathroom, which is my bathroom, not nobody else's bathroom. There's no line. There's no worry about getting jacked in the bathroom if you ever go to Yu-Gi-Oh! New York event. There's none of that happening, period. And I kind of like that. It's kind of fun. It's, once again, not as good as going to a locals. Definitely not as good as going to a high-scale Yu-Gi-Oh! Event. But right now, we can't do it, unfortunately. I wish we can. Trust me, I have no idea how badly I wish we can. And it kind of makes it more important for whenever you go and buy those cards. Because if you're buying cards and not using them, but you're just showing them on a deck profile, maybe you're playing with your buddy at his house, what value are you losing in your cards? Especially if you have high-rarity cards. Especially if you have a beautiful, brand-new deck. It's like having a golden sword in a golden sheath that you never use except sparring with your buddy. Put it to work. That's what I do. I always have the thing, even though I like the high rarities, I don't just get the high rarities, throw in a binder, and flex every now and then. I do that, but not to the level in which I like to go and put it in my deck and put those cards to work. When max rarity cards are being put to work, there's nothing better in the game, in my opinion. Anyway, Pazzles, I really appreciate you guys watching my videos. My voice is killing me right now. I really appreciate you guys watching my videos. Please make sure to hit the subscribe button if you haven't subscribed already. Hit the like button. Comment down below. Let me know what you guys think. It's your boy, Veen. YuGiOh. Man, YuGiOh have a great day.